symptoms management. I want to start with the definitions of palliative medicine. Is care that an approach that improves the quality of life of patients and their families facing the problems associated with life-threatening illness through the prevention and relief of suffering means an early identification, impeccable assessment and treatment of pain and other problems, physical, psychological and spiritual. At the first two theoretical lessons, you speak about of components of palliative medicine and about of a pain. Today we will speak about the treatment of problems, of other problems of physical, psychological and spiritual. Like you see here in this pose, we have a lot of symptoms. And one of that is the abstinence that we will see. The patient's is illness is tired and he's so much suffering and he have a pain. There are some principles of symptoms management. First, palliative care changed the perceptions of the diseases and made the medical world accept the responsibility to turn the last part of the patient's life into a period lived with dignity and comfort. The complete evaluations of the patients is essential for diagnosis and treatment. Please remember this last sentence. There are a multitude of symptoms that have different causes and evolutions, so a detailed history is needed to identify the cause of the symptoms and apply the correct treatment. Practical, we have some practical recommendations for complete evaluations. First, be aware of the importance of the non-physical, psychological, social and spiritual care symptoms, which often are confused with physical symptoms. When symptoms are difficult to control, there may be several causes of psychological, social, spiritual factors may be hidden. Use suitable treatments to maintain quality of life. Carefully select the medicine given to the patients, considering the adverse effect the causes. We must to start with a good history and physical examination, like we speak earlier. Discuss to the patients the treatment options. Help him make the decisions. Provide support education to the patients, the family continues. Strengthen the members of interdisciplinary team. Frequent reassessment of patients. Like you know, you speak early, like you study early, what is the interdisciplinary team? And who is a member of the interdisciplinary team? Is the doctor, is the nurse, is the psychologist, is the oncologist, is the dietary if is necessary. That is the team that consists to do a correct treatment of patients. And the team must to apply a correct approach. That's why we must the team to work together and work in the same vectors. That's why we speak frequently, we discuss the treatment options with the patients to explain him what options he have and he make to make a decisions. Is not possible if the patients can't make these decisions. We must to speak with his family and explain and help them to make a correct decision. Yes, now we speak about the classifications. Exist some types of a lot of type of classification, but we will start with classification by systems is in digestive symptoms, nausea and vomiting, anorexia, cachexia, constipations, diarrhea, respiratory symptoms, dyspnea, cough, wheezing, etc., psychological, neurological symptoms, depressions, anxiety, intracranial hypertensions, etc., hematological symptoms, anemia, hemorrhage, hypercalcemia, etc., symptoms of scar tissue, tears, lymphedema, and etc. Here you see another classifications. Is the classifications in prevalence of symptoms in advanced cancer. Like you see, on the first is abstinence in 95%, the second is pain 80%, inopportunity on anorexia 80%, constipation 65%, dyspnea 60%, insomnia 60%, nausea, vomiting 50, depressions 50, confusion, delirium 45, diarrhea 30, respiratory tract secretion 20. Like you see early at the theoretical lessons, you speak about pain. Today we will speak about all of that symptoms. We start with abstinence. And the structures of our theoretical lectures will be, we speak about the definitions, and after that about cause, and after that about classifications and treatment. Okay. Asthenia, definitions. It's a general weakening of the body which translates into the state of fatigue, which can lead to multiple functional deficits. Asthenia is a clinical syndrome characterized by general weakness as well as physical and mental fatigue. Asthenia causes. Exist some causes, multiple causes. One of that is muscle fatigue, intellectual fatigue, altering the perceptions of the environment, decreased vitality without depressive manifestations, personality change, various and changing pains, sleep disorders. Asthenia treatment. If you ask me if exists about treatment of asthenia, I will say you know, but we can do something. Also, it is a multicausal syndrome. Most of the evidence points to structural or functional abnormality of the muscles as a main mechanism of asthenia. These changes are probably due to a substance or group or substance produced by the presence of the tumor. In the minority of patients for whom a factor contributing to the treatment of asthenic syndrome is identified, its correction may be produce a major improvement. In most patients who whom the cause of asthenia remains unknown, only symptomatic treating may be attempted. Both corticosteroids and amphetamines have been, but is not efficient. And another syndromes is anorexia. What is mean anorexia? Is a loss of desire to eat. Anorexia causes. Exist two causes of anorexia. First is reversible causes, and the second is irreversible causes. Reversible causes we can treat if we identify it and we know what to must to do exactly. Irreversible causes can't be treated. For reversible causes, if we speak, is uncontrolled symptoms like pain, constipation, nausea, metabolic causes, hypercalcemia, uremia, problems of the oral cavity, like xerostomia, oral candidas, medication with cause nausea, gastric irritations, or the daily gastric emptying, anxiety, depression, spiritual problems. This is a reversible causes. If we know, if we have a correct anamnesis and we identify a correct causes and we see that causes is reversible, we can treat this. But if is the cancerous diseases itself, we can treat it. And if we speak about treatment of anorexia, exist some general measures, treatment of reversible causes, explantation to the patients and family, dietary advice, the patients is not forced to eat, small alcoholic beverage before the main meal, but here be attentive if he is not history, if he have no history of alcoholism, and continue physical activity as much as possible. For pharmaceutical treatment, we have some preparates. This is oral corticosteroids like dexamethasone 4 mg daily a week, then 2 mg daily, or prednisolone 50-30 mg daily. Well, it's very important to know we must to stop after 2 weeks because they lose their efficiency. Hormone therapy like magisterol, acetate daily, or medoxyprogesterone 100-200 mg daily. And another symptoms is constipations. Constipations is defined as a disturbance of the functions of digestive systems, characterized by daily to the seat hours 3 days. After some daily of the chair for 48 hours, can already consider it be constipations. The persistence of the daily of the chair leads to chronic constipations. The same, we have some causes, two very important causes. First is due to the tumor, the second is due to the secondary effect of the diseases. In the first case, one is due to the tumor, we have bowel obstructions intrinsic or spinal cord injury. On the second half, when we have secondary causes, effect, we have insufficient food intake, low fiber diet, dehydrations, inactivity, confusions, weakness, improper toilet conditions. Like we speak earlier, the same, the secondary causes effect, we can try to treat. The first causes effect is very difficult to treat, maybe only surgical. One is bowel obstructions in 3 seconds, or one is compressions. For treatment of constipations, we used usually Macrogol 13, 125 unit dose, 1-2 times in 24 hours. Lactulosa 10-20 ml 3 times in 24 hours, Bisacodil 5-15 mg by night. Siena is beginning with 2 tabs 7.5 and 8.6 mg 3 times in 24 hours, after that 2 tabs every 4 hours. And another and very usual symptoms is dyspnea. Dyspnea is a subjective feeling of weight, breath and discomfort, the result of the interactions of multiple psychological, physiological, social and environmental factors. There is a component, subjective, difficulty to breathing, objective, modifications of the physiological model of breathing. The causes of dyspnea is very usually is respiratory, that obstruction, asthma, pneumectomy, lung tumors, etc. Gastrointestinal, massive acid, hepatomegaly, that provides that increase diaphragm. Metabolic, bulimia, physical exertion, etc. Psychogenic, anxiety, depressions, hyperventilation. You know that early when we anxiety, when we are in depressions, we have dyspnea. And cardiovascular, cardiovascular is ischemic, heart diseases, heart failure, pericarditis, etc. Evaluations of dyspnea is difficult, is altered cognitive functions, if it's fatigue, if it's multiple associated symptoms. The same the causes of dyspnea. Dyspnea is due to irreversible causes not linked to cancer. Dyspnea is the side effects of treatment, oncology, medicine. Dyspnea is directly due to cancer. The same that is here we have that we can treat the causes when we can treat dyspnea and when we can not treat dyspnea. Here you see a depth when we can see in functions of syndromes what tumor is also associated with these symptoms and what therapeutic options we have. The first is syndrome of vena cava superiora, is associated usually with pulmonary cancer and mammar cancer lymphoma, and the treatment is radiotherapy, chemotherapy and other steroids. Bronchic obstructions, we have pulmonary cancer and lymphoma, the treatment is the same, radiotherapy, chemotherapy and laser therapy in lymphoma. In carcinomatous lymphangitis, we have pulmonary cancer, mammary cancer, or gastrointestinal cancer. The treatment is radiotherapy and steroids, chemotherapy, opioid, and anxiolytic. In neoplastic pleurisia, we have pulmonary cancer, mammary cancer, ovarian cancer, stomach cancer. The same we have lymphoma and leukemia. Treatments is thoracosynthase and tetracycline with chemotherapy. In ascites, in ascite, we have cancer ovarian, cancer endometrial, cancer mammar, cancer gastrointestinal and pancreatic. And one of the treatments is paracentesis to remove the liquid, and we give him diuretics. In pulmonary embolies, we give him anticoagulants. In anemia, we must do only transfusions of blood. Infections, in pulmonary infections, we have antibiotic. In insufficient cardiacs, we have diuretics and inhibitory of inhibitors of enzyme of conversions beta blockers and digoxin. insomnia. It's another symptoms. Is definitions sleep disorders, they may include difficulty falling asleep, maintaining sleep continuity, and unsatisfactory quality of sleep. The causes is stress factor of stress, non-controllable symptom, physical symptoms, the medication will interfere with sleep, and the comportamental of factors of patients. Insomnia treatment. Here we have short-term sleep hygiene. If it's severe and affects the quality of life, drug treatment, and long-lasting cognitive and behavioral treatment, good sleep hygiene medications, not for long. If we speak about drug therapy, here we have lormitazepam 0.5 milligram or tamazepam 10-20 milligram for short-term use. Please remember, we can't use not more than 2-3 weeks, and afterwards that we must change the medications. Zopiclone or zolpidem 5-10 milligram may have further side effects than benzodiazepines. And if the patient is waking too early in the morning and sleep, we use amitriptyline. Nausea and vomiting. What we must. Nausea and vomiting is an unpleasant sensation of imminent vomiting, frequently associated with pallor, cold sweats, salivation, tachycardia, and diarrhea. Vomiting is defined as removing food from the stomach into the mouth. Vomit is a reflex act that includes coordinated actions of the gastrointestinal tracts, diaphragm, and the abdominal muscles induced. Here you will see, in the brain there is a center of vomiting, and we have vomiting stimulated by cortex, by cerebral cortex. See here, it's a psychological stimulus, anxiety, pain. The second zone is the same, the brain in chemoreceptor zone, and here we see medications, cetosuremia, hypercalcemia. After that we have the VOMA act stimulus by nervus vagus. Yes, we have gastric irritations, gastric distasis, hepatomegaly, carcinomatosis, constipations. The same, we have hypertension, hypercranial tensions. And don't forget about is the stimulus of movement and positions in the ear. This is somebody will have some sensations of VOMA when he fly. And the same is the see and Now, see, I'm vomiting causes. Something, sometimes radiotherapy, after 20, 24 hours of course of radiotherapy, appear nausea and vomitings, and after that, if we have repetitions, he must be anticipatory. What we mean? When we know that we have today or tomorrow we have radiotherapy cars, it's appear a vomiting before starting radiotherapy and treatment in memory of previous therapy. Chemotherapy, acute delight of anticipatory nausea, vomiting, medications, opioid, antibiotics, anticonvulsivants, steroids, iron preparations, NSAIDs, estrogen, anticholinergic, theophyllines, that all provokes VOMA. Medication can induce nausea through different mechanisms. Gastrointestinal tract irritations, this is like NSAIDs. Gastric stasis, this is an example, is anticholinergics. Stimulations of chemoreceptor sub area as opioids. Relief of 5-HT3 from intestinal endochromaffinitidine cells, example cytostatics, other component causes, alcoholic, gastric ulcers, Koch infections, uremia. Here we have the same table with in functions of stimulus of what zone of vomiting center is is undrenating, we have different treatment. If is the system nervous central, yes, is the center VOMA, we have anticholinergic, antihistaminic, and antagonist 5-HT2. The treatment is scopolamine, phenazepam, prochlorperazine, and levomeprazine. If we have system nervous central zone chemoreceptor, we have antagonist dopaminergic like haloperidol, metoclopramide, and endosterone. If we some system nervous central by cortex, we have benzodiazepine and corticosteroid, lorazepam, diazepam, dexamethasone. If we have gastrointestinal tract prokinetic, we have antagonist dopaminergic like metoclopramide and doperidone. If we have tract gastrointestinal antisecretor, we have scopolamine, osteroid, and if we have anti-inflammatory and NISD, we have corticosteroids or dexamethasone. It's some tips of nausea and vomiting. The oral route of drug administration is only prophylactically effective after 24 hours of parenteral administration at the controlled symptoms. If the situations allow, switch to oral administration. Make sure the antiemetic is given regular administrations when need will never control nausea or vomiting. Use the right dose and right route of administration before switching the another antiemetic. Because if we give him oral administration, he will vomiting that administrations. Avoid use two drugs in the same groups that are there up to the toxic potential. The combinations of drugs with different mechanism actions on the chemoreceptor area or action directly on the stomach, do not use anticholinergics with prokinetics because they are antagonistic. The combinations of macropromide with scopolamine is unacceptable. Also consider non medicated methods, removal of odors, imaging foods, acupuncture, relaxations, etc. Yeah, what I wanted to know here, when is nausea and vomiting starting, and if the patients have opioids, we must to change the route of administration because he is vomiting, and it can be causes when the patients can say you that the opioids drugs is not help him more. We must to ask him what is happening, if he vomiting, when he vomiting, in how much time, and after that we decide what to do and what route of administration to give him. Delir, definitions, is alterations of consequences by reducing the ability to concentrate, support and change the attentions to which a cognitive disorder may be associated. We have some statistic in delirs. Like you see, in 74% of patients when delirium, the symptoms is reversible. It's a multifactorial syndrome, but opioids are responsible for the 60% of the episodes, 88% in patients with terminal conditions, or terminally ill patients are considered to be at high risk for delirium. Delirium at this stage is not usually reversible due to the fact that irreversible process of multiple organ failure occurs. In classifications of delirium, we have cognitive discarded, may be included memory impairment, disorientation, disorganization, thinking, or disturbance of perceptions. Consequence of disorder is an variation of patient's awareness of his or her normal level, alert or calm. He can be or alert or calm. In 5 seconds, he can change. Hyperactive delirium is most commonly present in alcohol withdrawal, amphetamine poisoning, opioid toxicity, corticosteroid administrations. Hypoactive delirium is show a decrease in the level of consciousness with the predominance of drowsiness until support on coma, and mixed delirium present alternation between agitations and sedations. Like I say earlier, the patients can be sedation, can be calm, can sleep, and after that he can divine very agitated, and he can do something, some agitations. Okay. Here we have causes of delirium. It's alcohol causes and the first, and after that antibiotic, and after that anticholinergic, and anticonvulsivant, antidepressive, antihistaminic, antiprokinsonian, antipsychotics, barbiturics, benzodiazepine, opioid, corticosteroids, digoxin, the same arterial hypotensions, period of apnea, fever, frequent pneumonia, and urinary infections, abscess. The neurological focars, anemia, hypercalcemia, dehydration, malnutrition, cachexia, and fecaloma. When we speak about treatment of delirium, we have antipsychotic medications that has fast actions with visible effects and few hours, 3 to hours, the indications of choice is haloperidol because this has the least anticholinergic side effects and minimal cardiovascular effects and has no active metabolites. And the same, the second is sedative, have indications in delirium associated with seizure, alcohol, withdrawal or sedative are an alternative of neuroleptics in the delirium state at the end of the day. The patient with delirium due to the hepatic impairment, lorazepam is preferred to haloperidol. And the last symptoms is diarrhea. Diarrhea definitions is defined as the increase in the frequency of defecations or fluidity of fecal matter, detectable risk of fractures. The most common cause for palliative care is laxative abuse. Diarrhea usually stops within 24 or 48 hours if no laxative are given. After that, laxative treatment should be resumed but at lower doses. Intestinal occlusion and fixed fecaloms are the second causes in the decreasing ordering of frequency. Incomplete occlusion may manifest as diarrhea or alteration diarrhea constipations. Diarrhea causes. The most common causes of palliative care is abuse of laxative. Diarrhea usually stops within 24-48 hours if no laxative are given. After that, laxative treatment should be resumed by a lower dose. Intestinal occlusion and fecal fecaloms are the same second causes in decreasing ordering of frequency. Incomplete occlusion may manifest as diarrhea or alteration diarrhea constipations. Another cause, iliac resections, reduced the possibility of reabsorption of bile acids, which are normally recycled. Total or near total colic resections are often accompanied by an ileostomy. Biotics can cause diarrhea by directly stimulating the intestine and alterating the gut flora. We speak about classifications of diarrhea. We have two forms of diarrhea. We have acute diarrhea and chronic diarrhea. Acute diarrhea is less than 3 weeks, and chronic diarrhea is 3 weeks and more. And if we speak about treatment of general treatment, is maintaining water balance is important in all patients except those at terminal stage of the diseases. Non-alcoholic beverage or commercial rehydrating solution may be used. Avoid drinks contains caffeine, stimulates peristalsis, and diet containing sorbitol laxative. Intravenous rehydration is used in severe diarrhea or when vomiting occurs. If diarrhea is severe, orthostatic hypotension, persistent skin, skin food, oliguria, hydration is done parenterally with saline and Ringer solutions. That's all. We finished our theoretical lessons with symptoms. If you have some questions, I attempting for you, and I will respond to your questions. I think you like my theoretical lessons, and I say you goodbye.